And we're live. Just as the Brandon McCatherine walks in, we're about to get ready to go live with his rounds. Brandon's rolling. Skaff's about to come in here and do some commentary. Thursday night class. Here we go. Tonight's all about the ham sandwich, I do believe. Brandon said he's going to look for, I think, 20 ham sandwich setups, finishes, sequences, etc. So, should be a fun one. Here is the one and only Matt Skaff.
Hey, whenever you are, sir. It's live?
Yes, sir.
What up? You guys see, I got a fresher haircut. It's not fresh, but last week it was fresh. All right. Okay, we'll see what Brandon's got in store tonight. I heard Keelan tell you that Brandon was going to be going for, he was going to be going for the ham sandwich. So the ham sandwich is a unique position. It's pretty uncommon. You don't really see this movement a lot. Now, it's definitely been used in some of the highest levels of the sport. I think of...
Cut, and it'll go to me.
Okay.
With the camera.
Okay. So I'll do that in a minute. So you guys are going to be seeing me for the next minute, and then I'm going to cut to Keelan when he's out there on the mats. But, yeah, the ham sandwich has been used, highest level of the sport. I really think of Hoffa versus Cabrinha, the first match they had when Hoffa was, I mean, just a brand new black belt when he won ADCC for the first time. He used this multiple times. He would get to that ham sandwich position, and you know, it's gnarly. It's a really gnarly knee compression. Now, Brandon most of the time uses this to sweep. So you're probably going to see a lot of sweeps tonight. I'm sure Brandon will finish a few of the ham sandwiches, but Brandon plays it really uniquely. He's really built a unique system, I should say, around this movement. And I'm excited to kind of see what his roles look like tonight. Now, he's been teaching this all week, so I'm also interested to see how the students react, because I'm sure they're going to be feeling, having seen this material, having been taught this past week, I'm just interested to see how they're going to react to this. There we go. I just cut now to the mat room. Yeah, a calf slicer. It's just, they're both knee compressions. Oh, we're looking now at the mat room. We see South Dakota Chris. He's on top of a visitor. This guy's visiting us from Augusta, Georgia. Augusta is about 5.5 hours away. I don't know his rank, but we see Chris going for the patented punch choke. Look how Chris is looking in right there. That's great. Yeah, and he gets the tap. That was a really beautiful display of the punch choke. Chris is really heavy. Chris, he really likes these type of like toesy passes right here. So you'll see Chris switch his hip, and he'll use a lot of hip switches to try and gain hip dominance where he can get hip to hip with his partner. You can see his partner tried to put that butterfly hook in, but look how Chris has just dropped that hip. He's very heavy on his opponent's right hip, and he's now stepped over into the half. Great head position from Chris. He's right up the middle. He can use that head as a weapon, so if he needs to flatten his opponent out, he could use it. Oh, okay, we got Brandon versus Lindsay. This is just a warm-up round, so there probably is not going to be much to say. We see Lindsay in this over-under pass. Oh, wait, never mind. They're just going over technique. Lindsay looking at this dog bar right there. So this is a dog bar. She's in the over-under position. Somebody used this multiple times at this previous ADCC trials. I can't remember who it was, but I remember somebody finished a couple of those. It's funny, I have a really funny story about the dog bar. I was training as a blue belt. I was training at Gokor Chevechkin's, and I got a couple of private lessons. My cousin's one of Gokor's black belts, and so I got some spent some really nice time with Gokor and my cousin, both black belts at the time, me being just a young blue belt. And Gokor Chevechkin tapped me with multiple, because my game was
very 10th planet based in the sense that I did a lot of quarter guard and half guard. And Gokor kept telling me like not to go to half guard because he was going to knee bar me. And every time I went to half guard, he would do this movement. One of the legends of the game. Lindsay's very, very, very skilled as well. Lindsay's been a black belt almost 3 years now. She's just getting ready to get that first stripe. What's up, Drew? Any chance, dude, Egghead, you're all about these wrist locks. You can definitely, I mean, there's definitely a chance with Brandon rolling that a wrist lock's gonna be used. So if you just joined, you're getting ready to watch Brandon roll right now. Him and his wife are just going over technique. Brandon's gonna be Friday and Saturday up in Cincinnati with the PGF qualifier, and so Lindsay's gonna be teaching. So I'm sure this is the material she's looking to cover Friday night. She's just gonna go over it one more time before she teaches tomorrow. Lindsay just very prepared. She always is super organized, and if she's got a job, like whether it's teaching class or she's doing the billing for the month, I mean, she just does it top notch. Truly a black belt on and off the mat. If you guys have any questions, you guys can make sure to post them in the comments. I'll do my best to answer them. But during the rounds, the main focus will be Brandon's rolling. And we're going to be looking at the ham sandwich today. So that was the curriculum Brandon's taught. And Brandon's been really obsessed with this movement over the past month. I believe this is the material he taught down in Costa Rica. Oh, okay. We got our first opponent, Alonzo. Alonzo just joined us. He is coming from a gym in Birmingham. I can't remember which one. He's been training about a year and a half. Can't remember if he's a blue belt or if he's like right on the like was right on the cusp of getting promoted. So this is where it's gonna happen. It comes off the scoop grip. You see, he's already in the ham sandwich. Brandon uses that scoop grip. And what Brandon's looking to do is he's looking to get his butterfly hook into position. The butterfly hook's gonna go into the thigh and he's gonna take the outside leg. Look, you're gonna see a great view right here. Look, right there, boom. And Brandon gets a triangle, just like a traditional triangle. Now he's gonna finish that calf slicer from top. See, we've already got two taps. You see the smile, he's like, ah, dang, I'm about to get schooled by the move of the week. Brandon sets this up a lot of ways, whether the guy's being a little over aggressive with his passing, like Alonzo was on that last one. He's just a little too high up near the hips. Brandon gets the scoop grip, uses the butterfly hook to elevate, and then he puts in that triangle. He weaves that his opposite leg underneath. It's kind of like a reverse entry, you see, except you're lower down and you're getting that triangle. You're getting that shin into the crook of the knee or behind the knee. But it's a similar play. So if you've been doing the reverse to X entries from like half guard or from butterfly guard, this is an even easier movement to set up. Yeah, Lazarus, the slicers are to me very, very underutilized. And Brandon's already in. I mean, he's already got five. And now you can see how Brandon's attacking. He's attacking that Aoki lock on the other leg. So it's really cool to use that position. So you can use that ham sandwich position to set up attacks on the opposite leg, because now you've got that other leg trapped. And depending on how they try and defend, or especially where the opposite leg goes, you can hit Aoki locks, you can hit toe holds. You'll definitely see Brandon hit some toe holds. Shoulder crunch, but Brandon's not going to use the shoulder crunch right here. And this is like a really good training video for you guys to see how Brandon works on a movement. You see, he had a deep shoulder crunch right there, but he opted instead to go into the movement he's working on, the ham sandwich. And so this is the first time we see Alonzo right there. He defended differently. So you can kind of tell, like, white and blue belts, how can you tell? Because they're getting hit with the same movement, but it's going to be the reaction. How quick do they change the counter, like the reaction to the movement you're presenting them? And so it took Alonzo 4 or 5 before he finally tried a different. We saw that time he stepped around Brandon's head, which is actually a much better counter to what Brandon's presenting him. Now he's tried another movement. This time he just rolled over, so he just gave Brandon the sweep. He's trying to keep Brandon's weight off him. You see how Brandon's trying to hip down into it? It's cool. Yeah, you saw Alonzo dealt with that much better this time. Nice overhead sweep. But to me, already fascinating stuff right here. Oh, he's going right back in. Look at that entry. Excellent. So we've seen Alonzo really use 3 different reactions. This time, he's trying to base on his foot. Oh, and now he's bringing that knee across. And remember I told you guys about the toe hold? There's the toe hold. So we saw the Aoki lock off of this, and there was the toe hold setup. 2 very devastating foot locks. So you guys are just wondering, like, how does he just keep getting caught in this? And this is a really tricky game to avoid, because you saw right there, Alonzo did what he's supposed to do. He won an underhook. He tries to take advantage of that underhook, but Brandon's setting him up. Brandon's allowing deep underhooks or guys to grab his head, whether, as Drew said, you know, Brandon's always gets me when I roll over for the guillotine anaconda. This is how he counters some of that game. This is his favorite counter. So he'll show his head. He'll lift his head to have guys go after. And here we see Alonzo on the head. And Brandon likes to even, like, allow guys to get pretty deep on the head. And he likes to try and find the ham sandwich. There we see Brandon, though, recover his guard. Really nice work from Turtle. It's looking like he's going for this darce. He switches. And now he's just floating. Got 1:08 left in the round. Oh, Alonzo trying to get that rolling Kimura, and that's another reaction that we've seen. And so I'm going to be interested to see the next guy, what some of their reactions look like. I think sometimes, yeah, Brandon's right back in on that toe hold. But to me, that's like how sometimes, like, I think you should be studying is not necessarily, like, if you were watching Hoffa Mendez, you're obviously watching Brandon and you're seeing him go for the same movement over and over again. You should also be studying the guy he's going against. Like, what reactions is he giving him? You can really learn a lot from the reactions. Oh, 6 swim move. Every 10th planet, like high-level 10th planet guy, should be a master at the swim move. Oh, man, that was disgusting. A little powder keg right there. Yeah, Brandon has to use that toe hold grip because his hand's broken. So it's really him just innovating because he can't really use his right hand. If you've been a long-time subscriber and you follow Brandon, or if you know him at all, you know that he had wrist surgery a couple of months ago. And his hand's still, I mean, it's definitely, I don't mean, it doesn't really work properly. Ah, here we go. We've got a young MMA fighter. Got a blue belt, Jacob Perez. Jacob is he's going to be good. Works super, super hard and just loves to compete. Nice. Jacob weaving those arms in right there. That's a good reaction to what Brandon's doing. Because you see Brandon's trying to get a vertical knee right here so he can elevate with his butterfly hook. He's trying to get a scoop grip, and he's trying to elevate with his left butterfly. He's using this shoulder crunch right here just to get Jacob's weight forward. Yeah, nice. You see how he used that shoulder crunch to get Jacob's weight forward, and he pulled him right into the ham sandwich.
Oh, dude, somebody actually did that accidentally to Brandon the other day.
Oh, man. Kimura. But you see, Kimura and toehold are very similar, and Brandon has the same grip on his Kimura as he does toehold. And it's not because he's like, I figured something like new, like that's amazing. He's really doing that because of the lack of function in his hand. Right back to this shoulder crunch. The shoulder crunch and the ham sandwich game work really, really well together. When Brandon comes on, you guys definitely want to ask him about that, or I'll definitely remind or ask him for you guys of the interplay he uses between the shoulder crunch and ham sandwich. Nice butterfly sweep. Yeah, Brandon's been obsessed with this, Keith. He's been obsessed with the ham sandwich for the past month or two. Oh, yeah, he's right in there. And this time, that's the first time. So we didn't really get to see that in the last round. Alonzo didn't attack Brandon's head, but we saw Jacob go for a guillotine. Tried to roll over into a guillotine, and Brandon used that to set up the ham sandwich. Oh, man, that was sick. So Brandon's like 175, and I'm 171. I've been 170 to 173 for the past like 2 months. I've gained some weight. Been lifting a lot. We got Brandon now playing some rubber guard. And I think it's really cool. We saw the beginning of the roll, you know, Brandon really, hitting and kind of feeling Jacob, because Jacob gave some different reactions than Alonzo did. Brandon got to feel the different ham sandwich reactions that he was getting. We saw him use more of a shoulder crunch because Jacob was trying, like an MMA guy, is trying to keep his posture and he's trying to keep his weight back. So Brandon had to roll him in with that shoulder crunch and then even expose his head to get Jacob to try and grab it. Now we've got Brandon playing some rubber guard. Oh, that was a disgusting armbar. Brandon's definitely, in the community, needs to be recognized as one of the best rubber guard players in the world. He's not the best. Ben Eddie's the best. Jeremiah Vance is the best. Those are the two best rubber guard players after Eddie Bravo. But Brandon's definitely top five. Brandon is a very, very, very good rubber guard player. Well, Keith, you look like Hoffa Mendez on that old boy, dude, in the gi. You were doing that man dirty. Nice. Octopus hook. Uses it to take the back. It's cool. I almost wish Brandon would have turned this even into just like a calf slicer. Like, he's going to go for the twister here, but I wish he would go for the calf slicer. And let's just keep this an all calf slicer video. Oh, dude, we get the wrist lock. Oh, there we go. The chat was calling for wrist locks, and Brandon delivers with the wrister. The wrister is one of the most humiliating moves you can get put in. Oh, man, this is something I've seen Brandon do a couple times over the past 2 weeks. I'm going to need to go back and watch that. He's getting a weird grip on the shoulders and pulling guys into the Dead Orchard. Dead Orchard, one of the best positions in all of jiu-jitsu. I mean, it's almost impossible to escape. Dude, gi dudes, they don't know. They just don't know. Another ham sandwich, and now we see him using the shoulder crunch. He's going to go for this inverted arm lock off of, and it's so tough because, I mean, Jacob's trapped. Yeah, and he gets the, I think that was a tap, but they're still going. And now he's got an Aoki lock on the other side. Oh, into the 50-50, and that's what Brandon was showing tonight. So this is the first time Jacob tapped to a leg lock. But Brandon's like, no, keep going. And he saw Jacob's movement led him. So like, that's kind of like the final movement for Brandon. Like, depending on how they move, if they're really good and they defend really well, then he ends up having to go and transition to the 50-50. Yeah, yeah, Keith, that definitely was like a sorcerer. Double arm bar. I saw him do that to Kevin Primo, actually. Kevin's just coming back from some injuries. He was rolling real light, but Brandon got a crazy grip on him and put him in a pretty crazy sorcerer-like movement. Yeah, Brandon told me, he wanted me to tell you guys, he was going for 20 ham sandwiches, but he's definitely, I mean, he's right at that. He is right at that number. All right, so here we go. We have our first repeat performer. So 2 weeks ago, we got to see Brad. He had received his purple belt that night. So this is a 2 week purple belt. Yes. No, you're exactly right, EJ. There's a lot of interplay between like the reverse X entry. That's what I'm saying. Like, if you already do the reverse X entry, then you've got that ham sandwich entry. It's even easier to get. But a lot of guys, when they miss the knee line, they're like, I lost everything. It's like, no, you could have the ham sandwich, which is a great sweeping position and a great finishing position, as you guys are seeing tonight. And so Brandon, he's hit a lot of ham sandwiches, and now he's allowing Brad, you know, to get a little bit deeper. Brad's a good player. Very, very, very slick. Good movements. But Brandon allowing him to get a little bit deeper, and he's going to now work himself back into a ham sandwich. Look, boom, off of the arm triangle. So Brad thinking he's got a head and arm. Brandon escapes, and he gets the toe hold. So all of these guys are making fundamentally a defense, like a big defensive error, right? They're all focused on their free leg. And so they're trying to move the free leg, or instead they need to slip the knee. So they should be, their first movement should be 45 degree backwards, and they should try and slip the knee as much as possible. Yeah, you're right. It was a Napoleon frame. The Napoleon frame is one of the most important defensive positionings that, I mean, I think everybody should be aware of. Get to mount. Somebody gets to mount on you. Look, you see Brandon's already got that Napoleon frame. He's got that elbow hand right across the bottom of the ribs. And if Brad happened to take mount, he wouldn't be able to do anything. It's tough. It's like when a guy, you feel the guy's kind of training on you and he's putting you through the same movements. It's sometimes you end up, oh, okay. Slick. But Brandon already out, counters the truck roll. He's already got the scoop grip and he's looking to pull Brad into the ham sandwich, and he's got him right back in that ham sandwich. Yeah, see, Brad, again, you see, he moved his outside leg. He ended up freeing himself that time. But you got to deal with the trap first. You got to escape your hip. So I've been saying you got to move your hip away from the lock, which is then going to move your knee. Oh, man. And there we have the reverse entry. Just a great practice from Brandon. Really just showcasing how to work and how to improve at a skill. I mean, at the highest level. I think you'll notice also something about Brandon is he's only done the ham sandwich on one side. It's always a left side or a left leg butterfly hook and the right leg weaves underneath. So if you were studying tape on Brandon, you'd be like, okay, I've got to watch out on the ham sandwich when he has a left leg butterfly. When he's got that left leg butterfly, it's going to be a reverse entry and it's going to be a ham sandwich. Got control of the toes right there. Those are really tough though. You see, Brandon didn't have a true lock on the hips because he was around both legs. So the breaking position is always going to be tough when you don't have true isolation of a leg. Ah, there we go. Brad attacks Brandon's head and gets the sweep off of the ham sandwich. Keith, I'm not sure when you were here if Brandon was doing much of the ham sandwich, but I think you'll find it really interesting when you try and attack his head, how Brandon's able to just weave that ham sandwich in it. It's pretty annoying. He's used it on me like a bazillion times. We have very interesting battles from this position. Man, this has been really fun to watch tonight. This has actually been my favorite session of Brandon because we're really getting to see him work and we're seeing him come in with an objective. And I always love watching guys when they have objectives. I love watching them train and how they just seeing how Brandon's accomplished one move so many different ways has been really eye-opening. These are 6-minute rounds. Yeah, he's got way more counters. Way more counters to the defenses of the ham sandwich. Oh, very cool. A little Jackie Chan entry. So we call that movement right there the Jackie Chan, and Brandon used it to get into the ham sandwich, which makes perfect sense. Like I said, the reverse entry and the entries into the honey hole, I mean, the ham sandwich is always right there. Okay, now we're gonna get to hear from the man himself. So if you guys have any questions, Brandon's getting ready to come back here and do a bit of a debrief. He's gonna be talking, I'm sure, a lot about the ham sandwich and kind of what he's thinking about. So we saw three main reactions from his opponents. We saw the opponent try and step the opposite leg over. We saw the opponent try and fall over, just give the sweep up. We saw that a lot in the first round. I think that was the first two, as we saw them just fall over, and then Brandon just followed it up and finished the ham sandwich. And then we saw guys trying to attack Brandon's head. Now, we saw Brandon use it in other situations, but especially on bottom, those were kind of the three main. And we saw a lot, so toe hold counters to when they step that leg over. We saw Aoki locks.
Can I get to 20?
Oh, dude, you got way more than 20. Awesome. Yeah, Brandon probably got 30. Probably got like 30.
In three rounds, I got 30?
Yeah, you got a ton.
Awesome.
I mean, just in the first.
I tried to go up a belt level each round.
Yeah.
So I went white belt, give myself some padding.
Yeah.
I went white belt, give myself some padding. And then I went to blue, and then I went to purple. And I had to keep the guys kind of like my size or smaller, too. Just forcing a spot like that is a good way to get hurt. If you're, because you're not flowing. You're guiding them. Sometimes it's not what the flow of the game is calling for. And you take them there anyway just to practice. You got to be careful doing that with heavy or aggressive training partners. Got to know who your training partners are for stuff. Whew.
Yeah. Oh, really, yeah. Really good stuff, man. This was definitely my favorite session watching of you. Watching you go in there with an objective and seeing how you accomplished that objective in a lot of different ways. It was really eye-opening to just a position, like a deep dive into a position.
A really weird position, too. Yes. So hopefully that's enough footage for everybody to at least, like, take something home and feel like you gained a benefit, you know. Like even if you didn't enjoy watching me roll, maybe you got a new move that you'd never seen before, never seen executed live before, at least. Okay. So that's not something you're going to find out there everywhere.
Yeah, no, it was cool, man. We saw different reactions, I was telling them.
I learned a new one, too. I learned a new sub, the Kimura.
Yeah.
The Kimura off of it. Oh, yeah, same exact thing as the knee. It's the same joint, right? Yeah. It's the same limb.
Well, you hit an inverted arm lock off it, too.
Yeah. Who was my second round? Who was that?
Perez.
Yeah, I had to back off of the legs on Perez a little bit because he was hiding away from me. He started putting his head down, so I started snatching his head up until he forgot what was going on. Well, and then I drug him back into it.
It's the interplay because you used the shoulder crunch and the ham sandwich off of each other. So in Perez, it wasn't necessarily the head. It was a lot of shoulder crunches.
Yeah.
And you were using the shoulder crunch to get him to commit forward, and then you would go into the ham sandwich. So how do you differentiate between shoulder crunches and ham sandwich? When is it time for a shoulder crunch, and when is it time for a ham sandwich?
So it's Jeet Kune Do. It's just the nearest available weapon to the nearest available target. So if his shoulder is close and it would cost me, like I never want to reach for something that's outside my elbow tight range, right? So if I have to reach, then I know it's that I'm grasping for something that's not ready to take just yet. This opens me up. This is a good principle that I use in my life as well. Like sometimes, like with a business idea or with a PGF or something, you know, if there's something right over there and if I'll just overextend a little bit, I think I can get it. This is when I'm the most vulnerable in my jiu-jitsu or in my life. So I try to make it a point, just a principle of my life, not to overextend and not to reach beyond what is in my grasp. If I need to get something that's out of my grasp, I have to move. I don't reach, I move. So if I go to tuck this way and the shoulder is right here because the leg is so far back, then the shoulder is the easy grab. But if I start to go deep and his movement brings his hip to me, then it's an easy grab on the leg. But I never go like this. Does that make sense?
So the honey hole entries, like reverse X and all of that stuff, very similar to...
Yeah, it's the same move as the honey hole.
Why are so many guys just bypassing that altogether? Because there's so many times guys could use this position in a manner that you did, whether it's to sweep or set up other attacks or even get the ham sandwich.
Or run them to 50-50, which is like when it all falls apart and nothing came from it, you ended it with him on defense in 50-50. I just think there hasn't been enough proof of concept. It's a new idea. It's probably not a new idea, but it's not something that you see a lot of high-level guys using. So I think there's just not enough proof of concept. I'm not out there competing, so you're not going to get the competition footage from me. I'm trying to eat pizza, you know what I mean? But hopefully, you know, we can put the concept out there for people to grab and do what they want with it.
How long have you been playing with the ham sandwich? Like, when did it get introduced to you, and then when has it really become a big staple in your game?
So it was first introduced to me when I was a blue belt from Einstein. He's the one that showed it to me. But I had no idea what he was talking about. He's the one that called it a ham sandwich, so I just always called it a ham sandwich. That's who I learned it from. And I really didn't understand it at all. And then Herzog, when I was a blue belt, Chris Herzog out of Rochester, he's one of my real martial arts mentors. I can't say enough positive things about Chris Herzog if you don't know who that is. But he's the 10th Planet coach up at Rochester, New York. He's a Sambo, I don't know technically if what the designation is, but he's a master of Sambo. He's like a 5th degree black belt in Judo. He's an incredible martial artist, kickboxer, everything. He started showing me towards the end of my blue belt when he came down for that week-long camp. Were you around back then?
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe I was a purple belt then. Anyway, he came around for that week. I was a purple belt because that was when we did our black belt test in Tung Soo Do. We did it that same weekend. What was I saying? Oh, yeah. So anyway, he was doing a whole week. He came and stayed at our place for a whole week, and he was showing all kinds of leg locks. It was just, we called it Leg Lock University. And that was knee slicers and like weird calf slicers was one of the breakout sessions that we had. And so he kind of helped me to see it a little better. Lindsay used to use knee slicers a lot in the early belts. But when did I really start using it? When you started attacking my head. Because you were beating me like ferociously. I couldn't stop you. I could stop you from grabbing my head, but if you got my head, it was like I couldn't stop you from doing whatever you wanted to do. And so I had to come up with a way to hold on to you. And I started instead of just, you remember, it used to be the lazy X, I used to call that position. But I didn't have any game really right there. It was just like a modified deep half or a modified X. But as you started flipping over to attack my head, I started realizing if I missed every other grip that I had, if I could just don't lift, but grab with that butterfly hook on your back of your hamstring, then I can stay alive for a second. And then if my back goes with you and my hips go this way as well as you roll over the top, then I can stay there and I can, almost like I'm playing inverted guard. You got my head, but I know I did it a couple of times tonight where I would bait them to grab my head and I'd let them go all the way through just so I could go out and grab it when they're not paying attention. So I would just invert and go back to it and then lace it up either upside down or kind of, it's the same move whether you're upside down or sideways or right side up. It's always the same move.
Yeah, the main reaction, so the first round we saw, it's funny how with the opponents getting better, you saw Alfonso was really...
Alonzo.
Alonzo, yeah. He was really kind of tore up. Like, he didn't know what to do. So his first four or five reactions were the exact same. He just kind of gave up the sweep, and then he finished on top with the ham sandwich. But we saw people giving up sweeps. We saw people stepping the leg over. We saw people
sliding the knee through.
Yeah, sliding the knee through and trying to attack and, like, jump over and go over top for the head. And you have counters to each of those.
Yeah.
All right? Which... I guess which presents the most trouble, like of all the counters to the ham sandwich, which is the one that you feel like is the easiest, but the chance for them to possibly get out and end up in 50-50.
So it's definitely the knee slice across the hip that Lindsay does, but that leaves the toe hold behind. And, you know, toe holds can be kind of give or take sometimes, right? Some people just, they don't believe in tapping to toe holds. And used to be if I had a toe hold and somebody would be like, no, man, you got to prove to me that you can tap me, then I would honor them with a clean death with a toe hold. Or they wouldn't tap and you get out. But now I know when I got it, so I don't really like... punish people for doing that like I should probably, but the toe hold is kind of there. But if they continue to turn and I miss it, they run into the 50-50. But the best, that's none of the things that happened tonight are the best counter. Lindsay's the only one that does the best counter, and it's when I go to lock it up. She taught it tonight in class. When I go to lock it up, she straightens her leg and levers her weight against my hip, so like my foot is up in the butterfly hook, and I get a step ahead of her, and I go to lace the ham right there. But then she straightens her leg, and it puts my knee pressure on my knee this way, so her weight is leaning in. And if I let her do that, then I'm gonna be very bound up, and I'm probably gonna hurt myself. So as she straightens and drops the weight there, I spin through the hole, and I get a good, like, that... kind of 50-50 bite right there. But she's got the best counter. Like, she can unwind it every time. She doesn't always evade the 50-50, but she can unwind it pretty much every time. She tries to crab ride. She tries to spin through and go crab ride, but I ain't into all that.
Yeah, well, 50-50 is one of the good counters to the crab ride.
Yeah.
You know, so that makes sense. it's funny, you know, we saw a lot of toe holds, and a lot of people were commenting on your grips on your toe hold as well as your grips on your Kimura. And a lot of that has come to the necessity of the lack of function in your wrist.
Yeah, my hand doesn't really work that good. I can't put, so you guys probably don't really notice because I just don't do it. I don't complain about it, but my hand doesn't work all that great. So I can't post on the ground with my hand, and I can't really grip with my hand with any kind of power. I can hold, you know, I can hold that, but if this starts trying to fight me, I'm going to have to drop it. So luckily that never happens with a soda.
How do you feel about your breaking power and mechanics with that grip? Do you feel
very
like,
good?
So you still feel like you can cause catastrophic damage to a Kimura
catastrophic
toe hold?
Yeah, catastrophic. Well, it makes it, I have to get everything else right. So the key to that grip is it's a karate chop down. So you're trying to chop the pinky toe into the coin slot. You know what I'm saying? So it's down. So I come through, lever that down. And then instead of trying to turn his foot, like imagine you went to the gym and you were trying to bench press. So like I got the toe hold, right? Instead of trying to turn the toe hold back towards him to get the bend, you turn your body towards him. Imagine you were in the gym and you went to bench press and you're very strong, and now I say, okay, now bench press that way, and you have to go like that. You might still could do it if it's a low weight, but you're not gonna, like, your power has been dramatically reduced because of trying to go this way. So I don't go that way, and again, that's reaching. So what I'm doing with my hands, my body turns and makes the breaks. So you go whack, and it's over.
Yeah, it was really cool. That last entry you hit was off the Jackie Chan. So you I don't remember. You did a low Jackie Chan. You know the Jackie Chan entry.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you just used that. Instead of, though, of going up high to the hip, you just went lower, and you ended up getting the lace into the ham sandwich. Is that a movement you use a lot?
Yeah, because I use that Jackie Chan movement all the time, too. So, but I use the honey hole version more when they're upright, like if they're standing and passing, that's when I weave that around and go Jackie Chan. But if their knee is on the ground, I can still do it. I just gotta be more patient. I gotta have a clean inversion that doesn't put me under pressure, and I can still make it.
Of all the leg locks that you've used, or that you used tonight, do you feel like the Aoki off the trapped leg, and then you get the Aoki on the other leg?
That's the one I like the best.
Is that, yeah, so.
I do it with the Shudo grip though. Okay. I do it with the other arm. So like if I ham sandwich here with this side, and then I grab, like I go to sweep, and I admired my work a little too much and let you get distance on me, then I snatch up and overhook on this leg, and then I lay down on it and I lace this one through, and I get either that power straight, or if they slip the heel, then I turn the elbow up and make the Aoki right there.
Yeah, that's super proud. We saw you use that multiple times tonight.
Yeah, that's my favorite leg lock to do from the ham sandwich.
So let's say somebody came and was visiting, and they decided to kick your hand or stomp on your hand.
When?
Just because they know it's hurt. Like, let's say it was Keith.
Okay.
Came from Ireland.
Okay.
What would happen?
I would just love him because I know that hurt people hurt people.
But yeah, it was really fascinating. So like going into the session, you know, I know you set a goal of 20, but let's say I was a blue or purple belt and I was looking to add a movement like, and obviously we saw from you, we saw all these different counters to different defenses these different opponents tried. We saw a lot of different submissions and sweeps off of that. We saw you in it from top and bottom, yada, 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 right? We saw a lot of different from you. But let's say I was just trying to get into the ham sandwich. How would you go about that, and how would you train for that specifically? How would you structure a blue or purple belt's training session into getting better at the ham sandwich?
At the ham sandwich specifically?
Yes.
I would just have them drill lacing it up. You know, I didn't get to do the electric chair counter at all tonight. Didn't come up one time. Isn't that crazy? Like, you know, because I put them in the ham sandwich and they go either straighten for the electric chair, they didn't straighten it one time. That's crazy. Anyway, I would put them on their spine, rounded back on your spine. You have the underhook with your right arm. You have the butterfly hook in on the left side, and your knee is tight to your chest. Bring the opponent's weight up here so that you're not bearing the weight, and then just practice lacing the ham sandwich or the electric chair. If their leg is straight, you make the electric chair, lace it, rewind, and now their leg is bent, lace the ham sandwich, rewind, and just, you know, the same way that I would tell you if you want to practice rubber guard, then you need to sit at home and just practice your kung fu move. I just want to see you lacing, making those movements until they don't, you don't feel any tension and resistance in it for the, from the uki anymore. The uki's feeding it to you, so there shouldn't be any resistance.
So we saw about 30 ham sandwiches.
All right, that's hilarious to say.
And yeah, and they all were with the same leg. Left leg butterfly, right leg weaving and getting in, weaving underneath and getting in that triangle position. So how important is it to like master one side? Do you ever use it on the other side? And like, why do people worry so much about being proficient on both sides? Like, you see that all the time. Guys trying to drill both sides.
So I'm a big, I learned this from Eddie, and this has been great advice for me over the years, is he said, master your strong side. And then once you have mastery of it, you go back and teach your dumb side, and you, your mind will already understand. It'll just be a matter of repping. You know how to do the reps already. So you'll be able to shortcut the process on the other side because you already understand it. But if you're splitting your time, you're splitting your DNA between two sides, it's gonna take twice as long before the mastery moment comes. Does that make sense? And so seek, people believe different things, but this is my firm opinion for myself at least. I seek mastery on one side, and once I have mastery, I can teach myself now because I understand it deeply. I understand the, like I got a system out here, but if I was trying to split it to both sides, half the system wouldn't be there. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So that would be my answer.
So on the right side butterfly, so let's say you have a right butterfly, right-legged butterfly inserted. What are you looking to do from there? So if you have
get to my other butterfly hook. I'm looking to, I can't go forward with this hand, and so I don't play on the right side at all anymore. I used to, you know, and I would just play half guard. Just I'd make it a half guard and dogfight until I could get to something else that I like. But now, like the whole game for me is built around hiding this from everybody, you know, and if you'll see, if I go and I'm playing a little like framing, kind of testing the waters kind of hand game right there, and they start gripping, I'll strip that and I'll be like, I'll just do something else. I'll hide it back here. No reason for it. Or if I can get it under your leg, you can't touch it now. So I don't go and grab with the hand ever. I just get up under there. So I really don't anymore, man. It'd be unfair to answer that question. I could give poor guidance.
So in your last role against Brad, you were playing more defensive. He ended up taking the mount.
I had to draw. He's smarter. He's been training longer. He's a higher level than them. So I had to lie to him more to get him in, you know.
So do you feel like this position, so he takes the mount position and he's got you in a head and arm, but you have the Napoleon grip, so you know you're completely safe. But you end up hitting this twice where you get into the ham sandwich off of the mount.
Yeah.
Do you feel like a truly good position should be always one step away, even from the worst bad position?
I might feel that way. I'd have to think about that. I might feel that way. I want to feel that way. I don't know if that's true for myself or not. But I mean, like, for instance, if a guy's hips are, if he's seated on me in any way, all I have to do is just get my knee inside. So any kind of bump forward that makes his hips light is going to give me a sneak in on that knee. So like if you're, I like the kipping escape. Oh, well, then you love the ham sandwich because all you got to do is sneak your knee in.
So we got a random question for you.
All right.
So if your guard while playing on your right hip is at black belt level, how would you say your guard on your left hip compares?
Brown belt. Yeah, it's not as good. But I tell you what is good, my ability to get back to the one I like. Because everybody pretty much after they get to a certain experience level, they try to make me go the other way. And so I just have my paths down on how to get back home. You know, I like to do this. This is like a big philosophy for my game personally. If the order of operations is normally step one, step two, step three, I need this, I need this, and I need one, I need two, I need three, then I'll get, it's too predictable. So I'll go and grab three while you're not looking. And then you'll pay attention. Oh, shoot, he got three. Now I got one. And then in a second, you'll move all I have to do is just be patient, and you'll feed me number two. So I like to change the order of operations up. And you see that with my rear naked choke. I go one, instead of going one, two, three behind the head, I'll go one, three, two, and I'll loop the rear naked choke like that. I do that with the electric chair. Instead of going lockdown, underhooks, bump, I'll go underhook, bump, lockdown. You know, just, it doesn't make any sense for me to try to force you to give me what you want. I'll just let you have what you want, and while you're not looking, I'll take from the cash register.
Yeah, I think that's a great way of putting it. And I think that order of operations is one of those slept on things. I think it's a concept that not very many guys are talking about or definitely teaching. And it's definitely a great way. I mean, we've seen it just the past couple of weeks. You've been using that concept to, really.
Yeah, I've been doing it live every week for you guys to watch. Just that small idea. It's a giant game changer.
Yeah, because, Keelan's a very, 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 very talented grappler. And, the only way you're going to get him, you're not going to force him into, a lockdown.
You got to lie to him.
Yeah, you
got to tell him everything's going to be safe. Yeah. Powder his butt, let him do what he wants to do, and then steal from him when he's in the bathroom. Take some money out of his purse when he goes outside for a smoke. You know what I'm saying? Grandma's out there smoking. I took 20 out of the purse, hit the road.
Well, is there any other thing you want to say? We've been on here.
I just want to tell you guys that I think that style of training is really important. That's a very, very, very important part of how I've formed my philosophies and my style and my game. And I hear a lot of questions. I'm not a real forceful, muscle you into kind of grappler. I'm heavy, but I have a soft movement, generally speaking. And so when I roll with people that I haven't rolled with before, that's the kind of question they ask me. Either how are you so heavy, or how is it that you don't feel like you're trying and you're still, And that comes from just investigating deeply. Like tonight's a data collection night. That could have gone really poorly. You know what I mean? I could have come on and said, man, I'm gonna hit 20 ham sandwiches and I'm gonna try a white, a blue, and a purple belt. And that could have been embarrassing if it really mattered to me. But the objective for me is to get out there and run data collection and not be afraid of what the results tell me. And so just the results are the results. If I come up short in an area, that's neither good nor bad. That's just is what it is. Accept that. I have new information. Make new decisions with the new information.
So we've got two more things to say, and then we're going to cut it.
All right.
So first, you've lost some weight. So are you still heavy?
Yeah. Yeah. 171.8 is my weight. Right.
I said you were 174. So yeah, you even lighter, but you're still heavy. You can confirm that.
Yeah. Okay. It's not been an issue so far. I don't know. Ask Keelan what he thinks.
Gravity's still 9.8 meters per second.
And then, okay, last question is.
Hey, I need my hat, coach. Let me get them glasses too, dog.
Once the ham Sammy is in, what is the order of operations? So what's the order of operations for the ham sandwich?
Let me tell you about the ham sandwich. So here's how you should learn it. You should go, your uki sits down, their left knee on the ground, and then they post their right foot. So they're kneeling on one knee in front of you with their right knee in the air, okay? You're going to put your left butterfly hook in behind their hamstring. You're going to either check their shoulder or get a collar tie or keep this hand to yourself. And then this hand is going to go underhook. From there, you move yourself all the way underneath until your spine is on the ground. Your hips, your back is round, so your hips and your shoulders are off the ground. And you should just practice lacing it from there. That's the main thing that you should do, is get comfortable with being in that position, and it'll become easier for you to find it in training. Because you'll recognize it as not just a spot of safety, but a launching pad for offense. And your body will seek it naturally because you know that it's safe.
There we go, guys. We're going to sign off. I'm ending this stream. The sun is lost.
Ham sandwich.